Hello everyone, let's go through the cell design flow. So let me recap a bit over here. So for example, if you have this placed and routed chip over here, so you the design, the logic synthesis step that we have presented in the last video, for example, this particular thing is a placement and routed version of the logic synthesis step. So you have this flip-flop 1 2 3 4 and all of them connected. So you have the D-in 1 to flip-flop 1 when properly routed, you have the flip-flop 2 to D-out 4 being properly routed, and so on. So you have these steps already done over here. So out of this particular typical placement and routed design, let me show you something. So if you pick up any of the cells over here, let's say you pick up the flip-flop 2, if you pick up the buffer, if you pick up this particular gate which is named as 1, they are referred to as standard cells. Okay, now this key or this term is really very important for us, is the word which is called a standard cell. Standard cells are nothing but in a typical IC design flow, we call these buffers, this inverters, this AND gate, OR gate, all of them as standard cells. Okay, now a standard cell is being placed in a section called as library. So for example, that library is a place where we keep books, where we keep lot of books, where we keep variety of books. Similarly, in an IC design flow, a library is a place where you keep all your standard cells. It can be even extended to more things, like a library is also a place where you keep all your decap cells, you keep all your macros, IPs, and so on. So library, one of the sections of the library is to keep the standard cells or to place the standard cells over there. Okay, so this is a typical area in an IC design flow where you keep all your gates and so on. Okay, so if you look into the library, it has got an AND gate, OR gate, buffer, inverter, D flip-flop, and latch, and ICG, and so on. But this is not all. If you see this particular library has got something more to it. If you open up the library and see, the library has got different gates with different functionality. For example, AND gate has got a different functionality than the buffer, and so on. So it definitely has got cells with different functionality, but it also has got the cells with different sizes also. So in this case, this OR gate is of a different size than this one. This OR gate is of a different size of this one. Okay, so the library has even that information as well, and those are the physical characteristics of the library. So if you take a buffer, for example, buffer is of a different size of this over here. It has got of a different size over here, and it is of a different size over here, and these sizes are referred to as drive strength. So for example, this is a bigger buffer. This must be strong enough to drive a wire compared to this buffer or compared to this buffer. This is the smallest buffer. This is the least drive strength buffer. So that is what the functionality, or that is what the characteristics of a library is. A library has got cells with a different functionality and different sizes, and that's not all. It has got cells with different threshold voltage also. So for example, this inverter will have a different threshold voltage than this inverter. So for example, this inverter might operate at, let's say, 0.3 volts of threshold voltage. This inverter might operate at 0.4 volts of threshold voltage. So the variation in the threshold voltage decides the speed of your cell. So for example, 0.4 threshold voltage inverter will take more time to switch compared to a 0.3 voltage threshold voltage inverter. Okay, so that's the difference between the having a different threshold voltage, having a different variety of threshold voltages in your library. And the more advantage if you see of this particular threshold of this particular varied VT cell is whenever you do a leakage power recovery. I'll get back to those steps in a moment from now. For example, for now, let us try to understand what does this library consist of. So the library consists of cells of different functionality, not only of different functionality, but of different sizes and of different VT. So this inverter is of different VT than this inverter. So let's say, for example, that's why the colors are different. This inverter may be of a different VT than this inverter because of the difference in color. And also, it's possible they are of the same size. For example, this inverter is of the same size of this inverter, but they are of different VTs. So this is basically a function or a place, or this is called as a library, and the library has got all these things. So the next step is to look into, let's say if you take into one of the inverters, if you take this particular inverter, you will be amazed to see the cell design flow. You will be amazed to see how does this inverter is coming into picture, so that it is basically understandable by a typical EDA tool. So for us, this inverter is nothing but a single input cell, but for an IC design flow, this inverter has got something else to do with it. The inverter has to be represented in form of its shape, in form of its timing behavior, in form of its drive strength, in form of its power characteristics, and so on. So this small inverter has to go through a typical cell design flow, and I'll very soon fill up this particular particular table over here, but the point over here that we are trying to show that the inverter, a cell as small as an inverter, has to go a typical steps of a cell design flow, and that's huge, and you will be amazed to see what are these particular steps. So let's look into those steps. So the steps, the cell design flow is being divided into three parts. One is the input. So basically, these are the inputs that you need to design your inverter, and then you finally design your inverter. And the outputs of the inverter are the ones that you actually use by your EDA tools. That is being actually used by your EDA tools. So let's look into all of them one by one. So we'll start with the inputs. So for example, let's take an inverter only for an example. And the inputs to design the inverter are basically to start with. Those are called as process design kits. So these are something which comes from your foundries, and the foundry provides the process design kits. In the kits consist of the DRC, LVS rules, SPICE models, and library and user defined specs. So I'll show you each one of them one by one. Okay, so there is nothing called as inverter over here, but we have to design the inverter based on the process design kits that is being given by the foundry. So let's look into it, let's look into each one of them one by one. For example, if you look into the DRC and the LVS rules, if you go through one of my courses, it's called a custom layout course. You might want to go through it. You will be able to see a lot of DRC and the LVS rules over here. But let me give you a brief idea over here. So for example, if you look into the tech file, that it basically provides you a tech file with some rules. So for example, over here the rules are, if let's say this was a polysilicon, this was your contacts, this was your n-type substrate, this was your n-type substrate. So the typical rules basically say that the design width or the poly width, this particular width, has to be 2 lambda. The extension over active, for example, the extension over active area. So in a layout, basically you call this as an active area. And why it is called as an active area? Because this is the place where you place your transistors. So these are all the snippets from one of my previous courses, custom layout. So you might want to have a look into that course. That course explains in details what each and every layer is. So if this is the active area, your poly extension over the active is the design rule specifies it's to be 3 lambda. So these are the typical feedback, or these are the typical inputs that we get from the process design, that we get from the foundries. So foundries have already done all these experiments, and with those experiments they have come up with a rule that your extension over active has to be 3 lambda. If it goes below 3 lambda, the foundry will not be able to fabricate that particular poly. Okay, that's where these rules come into picture. So there is one more rules. For example, the poly to active spacing. So if you see the poly to active spacing, that is it is expected to be 1 lambda. So what the value that you put as an actual value is basically the drawn value. But in this case, the value that the foundry specifies is basically mentioned over here. It's called as a design rule. So these are some of the rules. I have just shown over here the three rules. There could be thousands of rules. For example, the rules could be coded in something in this fashion. Okay. So there could be more than thousands of rules present over here that has been given by your foundry, and that has to be followed in a typical IC design flow. Okay, so these are the part. This is the first. This is one of the inputs that you get from your foundry. The next input that you get from your foundry is SPICE models. So, for example, if you look into the drain current equations, if you look into your threshold voltage equations for your inverter, you will see something like this. So if you look into a threshold voltage equations, it basically is called as the initial threshold, the threshold voltage without the substrate, and plus gamma 1 minus 2 phi plus VSB. These are all basically equations taken from one of my courses called a circuit design and SPICE simulations. You might want to have a look into that course to understand where are these formulas coming from. So if you look into the threshold voltage equation, it has got a parameter which is called as the foundry parameter. If you look into this parameter, this is again a foundry parameter, because the 2Q Na, epsilon, si, these are all standard values that you get from the foundry. Okay, similarly over here, so these are small, the parameters that you see, the one which are encircled over here, these values are the ones that you get from the foundry, and these are referred to as SPICE model parameters. Okay, so based on the SPICE model parameters, these are again one of the inputs that you get from your foundry, and based on the SPICE model parameters, I've just shown a handful of parameters over here. These parameters are spread across the table, so there could be thousands of parameters present over here. I've shown some example over here. So for example, these are all the parameters for your NMOS. These are all the parameters for your PMOS. If I want to show you one of the parameters, for example, COX, your oxide capacitance is epsilon OX by TOX. your TEOX will be given over here. So your TEOX is 5.8 nanometers. Your TEOX is 5.8 nanometers. For example, VTO is the threshold voltage in the absence of in the absence of bias. So VTO will be given over here. If you see over here, VTHO is 0.5 volts. Is negative 0.5 volts for PMOS. It's over here. It's negative. It's positive 0.39 volts for our NMOS. Okay. So these are the typical SPICE model file. We call it as a SPICE model file, and also it has got all the capacitances value over here. So if you see, it has got CDS, all the ones which are starting from C, those are all capacitances. Similarly over here, so these are called a SPICE model file, and those are again being given by your foundry. You have to use these SPICE model files, this DRC and the LVS file in as an input from the foundry, and design your system or design your inverter in such a fashion that that the inverter that you have designed, those follows this particular rules given from the foundry. Okay, and finally you have the library and the user defined spec. So what we'll do is, since I'm running a bit late out of time, let's stop at this point and let's start from the library and the user defined specs from the next video. Thank you.